Hey everyone, welcome back. So today we're going to be talking about a cool concept in natural language processing called Word2Vec. As the name would suggest, Word2Vec is a method that's going to allow us to take a sentence like this one, I like data science because data science is really fun, or a longer paragraph, and convert every single word inside the sentence into a vector. For example, a vector in two-dimensional space, but more generally it's going to be a vector in a much higher dimensional space. We'll keep things in two dimensions for this video so we can actually draw them though. And so we want to do this because if we look at a sentence or a paragraph, we can't really do any machine learning on it because there's no numbers associated with it. And so one of the very natural things to do is take each of these words and project it into some kind of vector space, or in simpler terms, assign some list, some array of numbers to each of these words so that we can actually do interesting things like figure out what's the most similar word to the word data, or what's the most different word from the word because. And Word2Vec is a very big step in that direction. So at a high level, what we're going to do in this video is take a sentence like this and convert it into vectors, one vector for each word, such that words that often appear close to each other many, many times, like for example, data and science are close to each other and there's multiple instances of that, that should translate at the end of the day into getting the vectors for data and science to be literally close to each other in the vector space. And so we'll see how Word2Vec achieves this very cool goal. But before we do that, we need to get a couple of ideas across, because currently we're just looking at a string of words. We need to turn this into some kind of structured data so that Word2Vec can do its thing. The first thing we actually need to do is delete some words called stop words. So for example, I and is are kind of just these common, everyday, no real meaning words called stop words. And you could leave them in there. It's probably not going to interfere too much, but typically we remove them because we're not interested in those common words. We're more interested in the true words in our sentence. So that's the first step. Then big idea number one is called skipgram. This is pretty simple. We first pick a window size. For example, let's pick window size 2. And then we visit each and every word that's in the sentence. And we ask, who are the two words that are to your left? And who are the two words that are to your right? We're going to call that your context or your neighborhood. And we're going to record all of that into this table here. And that idea is called skipgram. So let's just go through a couple of examples. The first thing we'll look at is the word like, and we'll talk about who are the two words to your left. Well, nobody on your left, but who are the two words on your right? Well, that's the word data and the word science. And that's why the first two things we record are like and data, and like and science, and they both get a label of one, which means that this main word and this context word do appear next to each other within a window size of 2. And we can just keep going, so we can look at the word data. Who are the two words to your left? Well, just the word like here, so we get data and like. Who are the two words to your right? Well, it's going to be science and because, and those get labels of one as well. And we just keep going, we construct this for the entire sentence or paragraph. Now, why can we not stop here? Why isn't this enough to just feed into whatever method we're going to use? Well, you probably noticed, but all the labels are one. And we can't really do much good machine learning if all of our labels are the same. That's like trying to build an image classification method that's supposed to tell cats apart from dogs, but you only feed it pictures of cats. Probably not going to do a very good job. So that brings us to our next big idea, which is called negative sampling. Negative sampling is pretty simple. We're just trying to fix this issue that all of our labels are currently one by introducing some examples of main and context words, which actually are not next to each other, not within a window size of 2. And so we just pick a number of negative samples per main word. Here we just picked 1 to keep things simple, but typically you'll have more than this, so it has many different examples to learn from. And so, for example, the word like and the word fun, if you look within these sentences, don't appear within 2 words of each other, and so we introduce that as a negative sample with label 0. The word data and the word really. Here we're talking about the first word data, because you have duplicate words data, so you kind of talk about them individually. But the first word data does not have the word really within 2 words of its left or 2 words of its right, and therefore we also give this a label of 0. Now we're ready to go. Now we have positive, we have negative labels, and this whole data tells a story about which words are close to each other, so Word2Vec should be able to figure out these patterns. And let's talk about how Word2Vec actually works now. So the first big idea we need to get across, and for me the most confusing part of Word2Vec, is the fact that we actually have 2 sets of embeddings. And by the way, a embedding, you'll see this word thrown around everywhere in natural language processing, but an embedding is just a vector representation of a word. So we can use this word vector or the word embedding kind of interchangeably. It's just that embedding is more context-specific to natural language processing. So the confusing part of Word2Vec for me when I first learned it is that for each word, for example, the word like data science, we don't just have one vector that we're going to be updating and hopefully getting to be better. We have two vectors for each word that we're going to be updating. The first vector for each word is called the main embedding, and those are the embeddings at the end of the day that we're actually going to keep, and those are going to be the answers to our initial question about how do we take each of these words and project it into some kind of vector space. So that's pretty clear. That's the answer to our eventual question. So what the heck are these other embeddings? These are called context embeddings, and the way to think about those is that the main embeddings tell us about what's the vector representation of a word, if that's the current word we're looking at. The context embedding of a word tells us what's the vector representation of a word if it is the context, if it is the kind of neighborhood of a different current word we're looking at. So hopefully that kind of makes sense, but the main embeddings tell us about that's the word we're looking at and this is the vector representation. The context embedding tells us about if this is kind of a neighborhood word, then how do we represent it as a vector? And although we're just going to keep this at the end of the day and we'll just discard these, we don't really need them, we need to carry these around in order to successfully update these and vice versa. So that'll make much more sense now when we talk about the actual algorithm of Word2Vec. So you can see it's pretty short. It's not going to take much for us to explain it. And we actually have a real example with real data that we'll talk about in parallel so we can actually see this in practice. So the outer for loop says for every row in our data D, so we're just basically just going to walk down this entire data set looking at each row one by one. And so the first row we'll look at is main word being like and context word being data with a label of 1. And that's what this example is going to talk about here. So the first thing we do is calculate something called a score. Now the score is calculated as the dot product between the main vector and the context vector. And then you run the result of that through a sigmoid. Now what does this actually mean intuitively? Well, let's walk through it together. If this dot product is very large, that means that the main vector we're currently looking at and the context vector we're currently looking at are close together in some sense in space. So that would cause the dot product to be large. A large number put into a sigmoid function is going to give something very close to 1. Remember, the sigmoid kind of squashes things between 0 and 1. And so if the argument in here is very big, we're going to have a score that's pretty close to 1. So a score being close to 1 is an indication that this main vector and context vector are close together in space. Conversely, if the dot product here is very negative, that means the two vectors are kind of opposite, facing in opposite directions, and so they're not similar. A very negative thing fed into a sigmoid will give you something close to 0. And so the score being close to 0 tells us these vectors are not very similar, not very close to each other in space. And so that's the first operation we do here. So we take the current embedding for the word like, which is 0.2 and negative 1. By the way, these are just randomly initialized values, so we're going to update these into things that make sense through this process. So the current main vector for the word like is 0.2 and negative 1. The current context vector for the word data, which is this guy, is 0.75 and negative 0.25. We take their dot product, feed that into the sigmoid, and so we get a score of 0.6. Now the next step is we calculate an error. The error is simply the label minus the score we just calculated. So the label here is 1. Let's think about why this measure of error makes any sense. If the label is actually 1, remember that means that those two words do actually appear close to each other. And so we would want the score to also be close to 1. And that would cause the error to be 0. Now if the label is actually 0, which means those two words do not appear in the same context, then we want the score to also be close to 0, because remember, a score close to 0 tells the exact same story. So this measure of error does make sense, and if we do it on this example, we get 0.4. And so the fact that this error is positive tells us that we want to move these two vectors closer together on the next iteration. Now let's say we're looking at the third example here. Then we would have the main vector for like is again 0.2 and negative 1. The context vector for the word fun is 0.1 and negative 2. The score is 0.88. and the error is negative 0.88. The fact that the error is negative tells us that in the next iteration, we would like to move these two vectors further apart because they're not actually context vectors. They're not close to each other in this sentence. And so that's exactly what we do in this diagram. So the last step we do here is we update the main vector and the context vector. And this word update, I've kind of left it intentionally vague, but there's a lot of different avenues you can go here. You can do something as complex as having a neural network behind the scenes, and you're going to use these errors to update the weights and biases in the network. Or you can do something as simple as literally just moving these vectors by a little bit in the vector space, such that these errors are respected. And so that's exactly what's happening in this picture. So we have this main vector like, we have this context vector data, and we have the context vector fun. And according to these errors, we need to move these two guys closer to each other. So like and data move closer to each other, and fun and like move further apart from each other. And so that is what will happen after one pass through all of these examples here. We're going to be delicately moving each of these vectors in the space, both the main vectors and the context vectors, such that things that are actually close to each other in their sentence end up a little bit closer to each other, and things that are not actually close to each other in the sentence end up a little bit further from each other. And then we can just repeat. We can go through this data set as many times as we would like, and each pass through there, we're just going to be doing these steps again and again and again. So that at the end of the day, these main embeddings end up in such a position that words that are close to each other end up literally close to each other in the vector space, and words that are not close to each other in the sentence end up literally far from each other in the vector space. So it's a very, very interesting technique, I think.
Hey, sorry, Ritvik from the past. This is Ritvik from the future when I'm editing this video. I just wanted to make sure I get the point across about why this works really fast. So for example, if we have the portion of our sentence that says like data science, like is a context word for both data and science. So if we're currently considering the vectors, the main vectors for data and the main vector for science and the context vector for like, the process we just described is going to move these main vectors closer to the context vector for like. So we get a picture like this. On the next iteration, it's going to do this even more. Move these two main vectors closer to their common context vector of like, so that at the end of the algorithm, when we discard all the context embeddings and just have the main embeddings, we actually end up having data and science, the main vectors, close to each other. So Word2Vec is doing this really cool thing of moving main vectors together who share common context words. Another way of saying that is that it's moving main vectors together who are literally close together in the sentence.
And the last thing I'll say in this video is, why do we typically not just have two-dimensional embeddings, although we use them in this video to be simple? Typically, your embedding size is like 50 or 100 or more dimensions. Well, think about a real body of text with many, many, many words. So you have many, many of these vectors in the space, and you're trying to move some of them close to each other and some of them further away from each other. Unfortunately, two dimensions is very limited, where you don't really have enough degrees of freedom to do this delicate vector dance. And so we really need to project ourselves into 50 or 100 or 200 dimensions so we have all the freedom of range to move these vectors in the delicate ways we need to do it. So hopefully this Word2Vec algorithm made some sense. Any questions are welcome in the comments below. If you like this video, please like and subscribe for more videos just like this, and I'll see you next time.